those of you not seated, if you could please find your seats. For those of you, period, if you could please find your cell phones. Turn them off, turn them to silent, turn them to stun, whatever you may. Thank you all for being here. We're going to begin in about a minute or 90 seconds, depending on how quickly Martin can walk. Thank you all for being here.
Good evening, everybody. That's really loud. That makes me sound kind of cool. Very, very glad to see so many of you here, and I'm actually exceptionally pleased to see a lot of really new faces that I don't think I've seen before, so please come back. We do this on a regular basis. Very, very pleased to be with you tonight, and welcome to Louisiana Memorial Pavilion. Also, like to welcome our live stream and our audience, which will be on C-SPAN, because we are that cool. My name is Dr. Martin Loicano. I am the Executive Director of the Institute for the Study of War and Democracy here at the National World War II Museum. We are sort of the research core, the academic department, the higher education center of the museum. We're a lot of things, and not the only source of education, but one of the new sources of educational programming here at this wonderful museum. We like to refer to ourselves as a community of scholars, and we have a number of our friendly scholars from the area in the audience tonight. We also do other things in the Institute. We are the Research Services Department, and if you have interest, talk to myself, Jeremy, Keith, Jason, one of our other people. We are research for hire for those who are interested in finding out more about a World War II connection in their own family. We also offer public programs, not just this, but we also offer symposium, full conferences, so day-long symposium themed on a topic. We offer several days worth of conference each year at the International Conference on World War II, and we hope you'll join us for those as well. We'll talk a little bit more about that after this wonderful program by tonight's guest. First, I just want to take a moment to recognize if we have any World War II veterans with us in the tradition of this great museum. We recognize them nonetheless. Any veterans of our armed forces in any other era or conflict, please rise, be recognized. And also, just specifically in reference to tonight, I hope that those who work in the field of studying and understanding autism as medical professionals and others might also take a moment to be recognized. Anybody here? Thank you very much. And a particular person that I need to single out is my dear friend and our dear friend of the museum, Dr. Gunter Bischoff, one of our presidential counselors. Who, where is Gunter? We have him to thank for recommending Dr. Sheffer for tonight's presentation. And so, as always, we thank you for your wonderful suggestions, Gunter. Is Melanie also here? And we welcome his wife, Melanie, as well, who's a wonderful friend and important part of this museum as well. As to tonight's speaker, Dr. Edith Sheffer is a prize-winning historian on modern European history. She focuses on Germany and Central Europe. She has a bachelor's from Harvard in history and literature, summa cum laude. I have a bachelor's from Louisiana State University, not summa cum laude. She then went on to get her doctorate at the University of California, Berkeley. She was on the faculty at Stanford and is now back at Berkeley as a senior fellow in the Institute of European Studies. Her previous book, Burn Bridge, How East and West Germans Made the Iron Curtain, is a multiple award-winning and wonderful book. But we are here tonight about her latest book, Asperger's Children, which she will discuss with us. This is a book getting very, very exciting national attention and early very high praise for its excellence all around. She has broken ground on the life of Dr. Asperger, and his name has certainly lived on and perhaps been better known than his life and work. And we are here tonight to hear what is a very difficult, a very challenging story, but she tells it in a compassionate and sensitive manner. I think a recent review in the New York Times of Books, power The New York Book of the Times Review said, Edith Sheffer has written a book that defies easy categorization, an appropriate, if perhaps inadvertent, response to her fascinating and terrible subject matter. On that note, and please come to these stairs, which are not dangerous, Edith Sheffer on Asperger's Children, The Origins of Autism in Nazi Vienna.
Thank you. I made it. Thank you so much for the kind introduction and the invitation to speak here today. Can everyone hear me? All right? Okay. And thank you. It is certainly an honor. I'm going to be presenting an overview of my book, Asperger's Children, which focuses on the creation of the... I'm getting some reverberation. Which focuses on the creation of the autism diagnosis in Nazi Vienna. And I would like to be sensitive to this subject. I know many people in this room probably know at least one person, a friend, a relative, a loved one, who has been diagnosed with autism or Asperger disorder, and the material I'm presenting is quite disturbing. But I do think it's important that this information be known. Okay, so 1 in 59 children are now diagnosed on the autism spectrum in the United States. This is up from 1 in 5,000 in 1975. This is an exponential rise. So what is going on? The reasons for this rise are much debated, medical, genetic, environmental, but one of the many factors is that Hans Asperger's idea of an autism spectrum took hold in the 1990s. For decades, we in the United States went by American Leo Kanner's idea of autism. Kanner looked at children who were relatively similar to one another. They had more severe cognitive impairments and more limited speech. Asperger had a much broader idea of autism. He included children with milder challenges, who we might today call Asperger's. And he is credited today with the idea we have of an autism spectrum. Now, Asperger developed his diagnosis during the Third Reich, and he has a heroic reputation as a resistor of Nazism, and he cultivated this reputation as having risked his life in order to protect children from the Nazi killing program that murdered youths considered to be disabled. And in this view, Asperger supposedly emphasized the special abilities of children with autism, stressing their value to the state. Supposedly, he was using the autism diagnosis as a psychiatric Schindler's List. So I set out to tell this story as a heroic tale of Asperger in the Third Reich. But when I went to the archives in Vienna, the very first day, and in fact, the very first file I looked at was enough to show to me that Asperger was actually complicit in the racial hygiene policies of the Third Reich. So I saw that this was not a heroic story, but actually a horror story. And I thought about abandoning the project right then and there. The files I was looking at were just too terrible, and I did not want to be telling this story. But I do think it has far-reaching implications for how we talk today about autism and Asperger disorder. Okay, so let's start at the beginning. Asperger was born in 1906 in the heart of the Habsburg Empire. This is 50 miles outside Vienna in Hausbrunn. He excelled at school with special talents in languages, literature, and history. He was most drawn to science, however, and he left Hausbrunn at age 19 for medical studies in 1925 at the University of Vienna. Vienna was in great turmoil at the time. It had been the cultural capital of Europe at the turn of the 20th century, the birthplace of modernism and glittering salons. Then, after defeat in World War I, the metropolis suffered severe political and economic crises. Street children flooded Vienna's institutions, and the city's child development professionals rushed in to help. Vienna founded one of the most progressive social welfare systems in the world. It was renowned as the Vienna system. And it had an army of highly trained social workers and, of course, eminent Viennese psychoanalysts and psychiatrists who were donating their time to help these children. One leader in these efforts was Clemens von Pirke. You've probably never heard of him, but he was one of the most prominent people in Vienna. He headed the University of Vienna's Children's Hospital and turned it into an internationally renowned pediatric facility. Pirke was progressive, he was open to experimentation and to the advancement of women and Jews. So when one idealistic Jewish pediatrician, Erwin Lazar, came to Pirke about founding a new kind of clinic, Pirke was game. So Lazar wanted to create a new discipline. He called this Heilpädagogik, which I translate as curative education. And the idea was to integrate medicine, pedagogy, and psychology to treat the whole child. This was a very progressive idea at the time. And Asperger would inherit this clinic. Pirke and his wife committed double suicide in 1929. They were found in bed lying in a close embrace after 25 years of marriage. This was a real shock. Pirke was replaced by the far right-wing figure of Franz Hamburger. Hamburger had joined the Nazi Party early on when it was essentially still a terrorist organization in Austria, and it was banned. Here is Hamburger inside a conspicuous sunbeam, the photo looks doctored to me, surrounded by a throng of adoring children and nurses. Hamburger was known for his anti-scientific attitude, and he wanted to undo Pirke's achievements. He wanted his doctors to focus on primary care and eugenics over medical specialization and research. Hamburger also purged Jewish and liberal faculty, and he hired faculty that would be on the far right. Well, one of Hamburger's first hires was the 25-year-old Hans Asperger. Asperger revered Hamburger from their first meeting in 1931, saying he was eager to help rectify the errors of Pirke's leadership. And here's a photograph of hospital staff. You can see Asperger on the lower right. So Hamburger placed Asperger in Lazar's curative education clinic and promoted him quickly. Within 2 years, Asperger was named head of the clinic at age 28. Over the heads of longtime staffers, people who'd worked in the clinic for decades, despite Asperger's youth and inexperience. But Asperger had solid right-wing credentials. He held memberships in several anti-liberal, anti-socialist, anti-modern, and anti-Semitic organizations. In 1934, just 10 days after Austria declared itself an Austro-fascist single-party state, Asperger joined that single party, the Fatherland Front. Okay, so bear with me. This slide bears fruits. This is from a digital history project I did with one of my graduate students, and it maps the creation of child psychology and psychiatry in the 1920s, 30s, and 40s. And we basically assembled a database of leaders in the field and tracked their intellectual and social linkages. So we looked at who interned with whom, who worked with whom, who joined the same organizations, who married whom. And what we found was that intellectually, psychiatry and psychoanalysis could not be disaggregated at this time as people trained and rubbed shoulders at each other's institutions. The Nobel laureate Julius Wagner-Jauregg, who you see toward the bottom in the big letters, was an important node in the system, and many were rotating through his clinic, the psychiatric neurological clinic, including Lazar. But many who tended to be liberal and Jewish opted to go into the trendier field of psychoanalysis. And you can see those figures on the lower side of the screen. You see Anna and Sigmund Freud hanging out. Clemens von Pirke and Lazar had been tied to those networks there in the middle, but you see Hamburger and Asperger are very isolated up in the top with the far right-wing psychiatrists. And so what this slide shows is that the ideological split in psychiatry predated the Nazi annexation of Vienna. Vienna's institutions and psychiatric community were already divided, and Asperger and his crew were already far off from the mainstream. See, I told you, the slide works. Okay, meanwhile, let's go inside Asperger's curative education clinic, where there's a different, more progressive bent. Nurse and educational director Victorina Tack generated many of their therapies and published articles on the importance of compassion and play-based techniques. We would recognize many of her techniques today. Following her lead, clinic staff paid attention to youths who seemed to have difficulty socializing, and the staff collectively called these children autistic. This is as early as 1934, they were using the term autistic. But they did not consider autistic a negative pathology. It was a character trait. So ward physician Georg Frankel and psychologist Annie Weiss each published articles about autistic characteristics in the mid-1930s. Frankel and Weiss were both Jewish and soon emigrated to the United States. For those of you who might know the history of Leo Kanner, they immigrated with his help. He was the father of American psychiatry who created the autism diagnosis. And this is speculation in my book. We don't know this, but it needs more research. I think that Weiss and Frankel may have brought the idea of autism to Kanner across the Atlantic because Kanner greatly admired Frankel's work, and his first case study of autism was based on Frankel's notes. Meanwhile, in Nazi Germany in the 1930s, Nazi child psychiatrists were also diagnosing social awkwardness in youths, but were much, much harsher about it. So children in the Third Reich were to possess strong community bonds. They were supposed to be enthusiastic participants in collective activities such as the Hitler Youth. And this was the idea of fascism at the heart of Nazism. And that's what I hope to achieve with my book, showing this idea of the fascist collective belonging that the Nazi psychiatrists so prized. So Paul Schroeder, who's on the upper left, was the leader of Nazi child psychiatry, and he called this readiness to serve the community Gemüt. And now Gemüt is one of Germany's famously untranslatable words. In the Romantic period, it meant soul. I'll just stick to how Nazi child psychiatrists used it, which was a deep sense of metaphysical connectedness to the greater organism. And it had a national, racial meaning. Germans had a lot of Gemüt. The French didn't have Gemüt, they had reason. Socialists and communists didn't have Gemüt. Hitler had a lot of Gemüt. It signified deepness and metaphysical connection. So another man Asperger followed was Schroeder's student next to him, Hans Heinze, who also wrote on Gemüt, and he became one of the top three leaders in the Nazi euthanasia program. So I won't go into detail, but this is a sampling of different diagnoses that Nazi child psychiatrists were devising. Here you see 3x4 matrices of Gemüt, or strings of percentages quantifying children's ability to socialize, their heritability, supposedly their parents weren't able to socialize. And so the point here is that the idea of autism pervaded Nazi child psychiatry long before Asperger named it. Asperger was a very young man at this time, and he was deeply influenced by these diagnoses of social maladjustment. So when his time came, he would simply follow in their footsteps. So on the morning of March 12, 1938, the German Wehrmacht rolls across the border into Austria and met jubilant crowds. Asperger in Vienna witnessed tremendous change. There was vicious violence against Jews, regarded by many as the worst in the Reich. People assaulted Jews in the streets, plundered homes, their stores, and synagogues. At the University of Vienna, Asperger's colleagues were purged en masse. The medical school removed 78% of its faculty, 78% of Asperger's colleagues. including 3 Nobel Prize winners. Hamburger and Asperger's clinics survived unscathed. In fact, Asperger and his colleagues even thrived during the Third Reich. The expulsion of so many liberals and Jews created a vacuum that expanded their opportunities. For Asperger, one opportunity was naming his own diagnosis. In 1937, before the Nazi annexation, Asperger had warned against creating childhood diagnoses. He asserted that there are as many approaches as there are different personalities. It is impossible to establish a rigid set of criteria for a diagnosis. Then, just months after the annexation, Asperger introduces his own diagnosis. This well-characterized group of children, who we name autistic psychopaths, because the confinement of the self has led to a narrowing of their relations to the environment. So most striking, Asperger is calling autism a psychopathy, which carried connotations in German psychiatry of criminality and depravity. He was moving from the non-judgmental tradition of the curative education clinic, which talked about autistic children as a character trait, and now he's moving into the realm of Nazi psychiatry. Also, right after the annexation, Asperger begins to work for the Nazi government right away in April 1938. He begins to consult for the juvenile justice system and the city's remedial schools. He quickly joins several Nazi organizations, the German Labor Front, the National Socialist People's Welfare Organization, which was not remarkable for someone ambitious, and he also applied to consult for the Hitler Youth. Asperger did not join the Nazi Party, and this is one reason why people have seen him as a resistor and one reason why he called himself a resistor. But not joining the party was not unusual for someone in his position. Only 3 in 10 doctors in Vienna joined the Nazi Party. And besides, Hamburger was a prominent Nazi and was already vouching for Asperger. He kept Asperger on as head of the curative education clinic when he believed that doctors had to be downright saturated with National Socialist principles. That's a quote. Hamburger also trusted Asperger in the leadership of one of his signature programs, motorized mother advising. They would drive out to rural areas in this health car and dispense medical advice to people in need, which sounds great, right? At the same time, they were acting as the eyes and ears of the regime. They were registering children who were disabled and who came from families where there might be alcoholism or hereditary illness, assembling records that were later put to use for the children's deportation and extermination. In the fall of 1940, Asperger began to work as a consultant for Vienna's public health office. This was the center of racial hygiene measures in the city. It coordinated forced sterilizations, deportations to concentration camps, and killings of people considered to be disabled. So to give you some background on the child euthanasia program, this was the Reich's first program of mass extermination. It predated the Holocaust. It was begun by Hitler in 1939 to get rid of children regarded as a drain on the state and a danger to its gene pool. But I can't emphasize enough how euthanasia was a misnomer. The vast majority of children were physically healthy. They were not terminally ill, and they were not physically suffering. They were simply deemed to have physical, mental, or behavioral defects. At least 5,000 children perished in around 37 special wards in the Reich. This is inside Germany. Spiegelgrund in Vienna was one of the deadliest, where almost 800 children perished. And many, many ordinary people knew what was happening. Newspapers tried to deny the killings, but there were public protests on the street in the fall of 1940, dispersed by the police and SS. And so Asperger certainly knew what was going on at Spiegelgrund, as he admitted later in life. There's no question Asperger knew what was happening. In contrast to our mechanized images of the Holocaust, the child euthanasia program was very different. It was supposed to become a permanent part of the Reich's healthcare system. So the Holocaust, the killing of other groups, was happening in a haphazard fashion, and it was meant to be secret. This was a permanent part of healthcare in the Reich. This was supposed to be legal. And this was intimate killing, typically by the very doctors and nurses, especially women, who cared for their ward's daily needs. And killings were done in the youth's own beds, as staff issued youths overdoses of barbiturates until the children grew ill and died, usually of pneumonia. Asperger was at the eye of the storm of the euthanasia program, close to its top leaders in Vienna. So Franz Homburger, of course, was Asperger's mentor and collaborator for 13 years, and he authorized dozens of transfers of children to Spiegelgrund. Homburger also conducted numerous lethal experiments at the children's hospital while Asperger effectively worked down the hall. Asperger's fellow postdoctoral students were depriving babies of fats, of vitamin A. They were infecting babies and children with tuberculosis. All kinds of medical experiments were happening in plain sight at this hospital. In 1941, Asperger and Homburger co-founded with Max Gundel the Vienna Society for Curative Education. Asperger was the second vice president of this organization. Gundel was head of racial hygiene in Vienna. He was known for accelerating the deportation of Jews to concentration camps, and he was municipal director of Spiegelgrund. He was on the administrative side of Spiegelgrund. Another co-founder of Asperger's Society was Erwin Jekelius, who was a fellow postdoctoral student of Homburger's, of Asperger's under Homburger, and he was also the head of the adult euthanasia facility at Steinhof, where thousands of adults were killed. And Jekelius was infamous. Everyone in Vienna knew who he was. He was widely called the mass murderer of Steinhof. The BBC reported on Jekelius's activities, and the Royal British Air Force even dropped leaflets calling him the Lord with the syringe. Jekelius was engaged to Hitler's sister, Paula. You can see the resemblance. Hitler greatly disapproved of the match. We don't know why. Perhaps he didn't want his sister marrying a mass murderer. But he had Jekelius, that's what people speculate. He had Jekelius apprehended during a trip to Berlin in December 1940 and dispatched to the Eastern Front, which is an effective way to get rid of an undesirable brother-in-law, right? Send him to the Eastern Front. Okay, so not only did Asperger associate with the top leaders of Spiegelgrund, he advocated the transfer of the most disabled children to Spiegelgrund. So this is a talk he gave in Vienna and then published in the Munich Medical Weekly. He said that for all difficult cases, only a long and continuous observation is proper, like those carried out at my own clinic or in the reformatory Spiegelgrund. And Asperger followed his own advice. He transferred children to Spiegelgrund in numerous capacities, is working for the public health office and working for remedial schools. And just for one example, he served as a medical expert on a 7-member commission for the city that evaluated children's transfer from one care facility to other destinations. And in one day, they evaluated 192 files and dispatched 35 children to Spiegelgrund as, quote, incapable of educational and developmental engagement. In one day, they decided that these children were ineducable. And this is a death sentence, and in fact, all 35 children were killed. So it's unknown and will probably remain unknown due to the fragmentary record base how many children Asperger transferred, but we do know that there are two children he transferred directly from his clinic who died at Spiegelgrund. 2.5-year-old Hertha Schreiber was the youngest of 9 children. She was severely disabled by meningitis and diphtheria. Asperger concluded that, quote, her accommodation in Spiegelgrund is absolutely necessary. Herta's mother reportedly told the presiding doctor at Spiegelgrund, because sometimes parents brought their children to these places in order to be killed. Parents had themselves death wishes for their children. Herta's mother said, quote, if the child could not be helped, perhaps it would be better if she should die, as she would have nothing in this world anyway. Herta did die 2 months after Asperger's transfer. Asperger also recommended the transfer of 5-year-old Elizabeth Schreiber to Spiegelgrund. One nurse there wrote in a daily report that Elizabeth could only speak a single word, mama, and that she, quote, has a friendly nature, is very affectionate and flattering with caregivers. If she is treated strictly, she will cry and hug the nurse. Elizabeth was killed 4 months after she was admitted to Spiegelgrund and her brain harvested, kept in a collection of over 400 children's brains in Spiegelgrund's cellar. So one thing I really want to show in my book is that Asperger's definition of autism was happening at the same time. He was developing his definition of autism as these child killings were happening. So remember, he'd written in 1937 that it's impossible to establish a diagnosis for children, right? No such thing. We can't do it. Children are too unique. Then, months after the annexation, he comes out with what he calls a well-characterized group of children, autistic psychopaths, and they have a narrowed relation to the environment. Well, in 1940, he changes his definition somewhat. He calls a group of abnormal children, who we refer to as autistic psychopaths, these loner children fall out of every community. They live their own lives without an emotional relationship with the environment and therefore also react abnormally to the needs of the environment. So here Asperger's language is more pejorative, right? It's more critical. These are abnormal children behaving abnormally, and he's more concerned with social connectedness. These children are loners and they have a defect of emotion. Then in 1944, Asperger writes his postdoctoral thesis for promotion, and he ratchets his rhetoric up another notch. In it, he writes, the autist is only himself and not an active member of the greater organism which he is influenced by and which he influences constantly. Well, now this is fascist language. We have children's membership in a greater organism, right? This is the fascism of the greater organism of the folk. He also, in his thesis, adopts Nazi psychiatry's core tenet of Gemüt. Remember Gemüt? Finally, he calls autism a disharmony of Gemüt, and he cites all those guys I showed you in Nazi child psychiatry. His language is also quite harsh. He increasingly stressed the cruelty and sadistic traits of autistic psychopaths, of autistic acts of malice. So year by year, Asperger is changing his definition to become more and more pejorative and more concerned with children's aptitude for community. So Asperger did prize what he saw as the, quote, special abilities of some autistic children in math and other technical subjects. And he said they were on the favorable end of an autism range. But this was a highly gendered view. He declared that, quote, the autistic personality is an extreme variant of male intelligence, of the male character. And so he's echoing stereotypes of the time. He's saying boys have a gift for logical ability, abstraction, precise thinking, and formulating, whereas girls, quote, are more gifted for the concrete and practical. In autism, he said, the male pattern is exaggerated to the extreme. And whereas Asperger believed that many of the boys could be remediated due to their unique male intelligence, he gave these boys intensive help and therapy, he was far more dismissive of girls who showed the same traits. The girls were not to be remediated or educated, but he recommended them for treatment, hormone treatment, or sterilization, or worse. Let's start with the boys. So in one of his two most prominent case studies of autistic psychopathy, Asperger said that Fritz, quote, fell out of the community. It was impossible to get him to play in a group. His eye gaze was odd and mostly went into space. In his second major case study, Asperger said Haro, quote, never would join a game with others, and his, quote, lost gaze was often far away. Asperger said both boys should be treated with, quote, genuine care and kindness and true understanding and affection. And this is the image of Asperger we have today, right? He treats these boys with love and kindness and values their special abilities. And he gave them specialized tutoring on the ward and play therapy. Well, in the archives, this is an unpublished case file I found of Christine Burka, and he describes her in similar terms as the boys. She was, quote, difficult to influence from the outside. She was closed, inhibited, hard to reach. She, quote, never cared for the other children. So indistinguishable. We can't know what Christina really looked like, but he's seeing her in the same way. Asperger's clinic concluded, however, that she simply had kein Gemüt, no Gemüt. You can see that note there. And Asperger's official diagnosis of Christine was not a psychiatric diagnosis, but a moral diagnosis. She had a character variant, and you can see his handwriting. He was born left-handed, but had to learn to write with his right hand, so lucky me, that's his handwriting at the bottom. Because she posed a significant criminal threat, Asperger ordered her transferred to a correctional institution. She was egocentric, vulgar, oppositional, and underhanded. In other unpublished case files, I saw that Elfriede Grohmann and Margarita Schaffer met even worse fates than Christina. Asperger's clinic said that Margarita, quote, did not participate at all in the community of children. Her, quote, facial expression was remarkably empty, and she would stare impassively before her with, quote, a lack of contact. Elfriede was supposedly oblivious, quote, to the effect of her entire behavior on others. So again, we can't know what these girls actually looked like, but they were described in similar terms. Asperger's clinic transferred both girls to Spiegelgrund. Clinic notes here state that staff introduced Margarita to Jekelius, that's underlined, suggesting she may have been pre-selected. And indeed, she was transferred to Spiegelgrund the same day. Asperger's clinic here specifies that Elfriede should be sent to Dr. Illing's department, and that was the killing department. He was in charge of that at the time. Elfriede already had a sense of foreboding before her transfer. She wrote to her mother, quote, I do not know if we will see each other again because I can't know if I won't die on this trip. Thankfully, there is no record of the girls' deaths, despite them being handed over directly to Spiegelgrund doctors Jekelius and Illing. But the fact remained that Asperger was issuing diverse fates to children with similar traits. So Asperger's eugenicist view of gender was of a piece with his eugenicist view of autistic psychopathy in general. Some laud Asperger's effusive language about the highly original genius of children at the most favorable end of his autistic range, and he did say that they might excel in science or other technical professions. But this benevolent rhetoric was in keeping with Nazi psychiatry. Many Nazi psychiatrists said a lot of nice things about children that they thought could be of value. We only see the exterminationist side of Nazi psychiatry, but they valued children that they thought could be brought into the folk. But children who they were deemed unworthy of life were made this harsh distinction. And Asperger was no exception. He said the autism spectrum ranged, quote, down to the most automaton-like mentally retarded individual. They would grow up, he said, to, quote, roam the streets as originals, grotesque and dilapidated. These children could not and would not be helped. Thus, by 1944, as he's seeking promotion under Hamburger, Asperger's definition of autistic psychopathy was deeply shaped by Nazi institutions and ideology. After the war, Asperger claimed that he had resisted Nazism and defended children from the euthanasia killings. He also distanced himself from his Nazi-era work. He hardly ever wrote about autistic psychopathy again, just a handful of articles, which makes me wonder the extent to which he ever believed in it, or if he was just up for promotion. Rather, he turned to religious themes and social commentary on child rearing. Asperger probably would have been a footnote in the history of autism research had it not been for this woman, Lorna Wing. She was a leading British psychiatrist who publicized Asperger's diagnosis almost 40 years later in 1981. Wing had switched fields to child psychiatry when her daughter, Susie, was diagnosed with autism. And she herself had conducted extensive research, more extensive than Asperger ever had, about youths who she felt did not fit into Kanner's definition. When she published her work, however, she called it Asperger syndrome as a professional courtesy. What she was describing, though, was more her own diagnosis than Asperger's work. She wanted to present a neutral condition, so she named it a syndrome. She did not call it a psychopathy, and she dropped Asperger's fascist rhetoric, and she got rid of him saying that the children were sadistic and grotesque. She wrote what we would consider a neutral diagnosis. As Lorna Wing's idea of a broader autism spectrum gained traction in the 1980s and 90s, the American Psychiatric Association added Asperger disorder to the American Manual of Mental Disorders, the DSM-IV, in 1994. And they did not research Asperger's Nazi-era activities. Usually when you award an eponymous diagnosis, you're supposed to research the person you're naming a diagnosis after, and the APA did not. So that's why we're in the situation we're in today. So this rainbow is a simplistic image of the autism spectrum that took hold in the public mind. And you can see it's basically an IQ chart. On the far left is Kanner's idea of classic autism, children with greater impairments, with Asperger's disorder on the far right. So Asperger's disorder was increasingly seen as indistinguishable from high-functioning autism. I hate the terms high-functioning and low-functioning, but these are terms that are in common usage. And Asperger disorder was reclassified in 2013 in the DSM-5 as autism spectrum disorder. So it no longer exists as a medical diagnosis, although it does internationally. In this country, it no longer does. And socially, Asperger's name remains in wide usage. It's an identity for millions of people. It's a term we apply to loved ones, and it's a personality stereotype in popular culture. Most of us never think about the man behind the name. And so the question that this work now brings up is, does the man matter? And to medical ethics, it does. Because in medicine, naming a disorder after someone is meant to credit that individual for describing a condition and to honor them for their work. And in my opinion, Asperger merits neither. First, he did not discover autism. His portrayal of autistic psychopaths is at odds with understandings of autism today. We don't see autistic children in terms of sadism and depravity. Besides, Asperger's fascist idea of Gemüt was not even his own. He was following in the footsteps of his senior colleagues in Nazi child psychiatry. Second, of course, I don't think Asperger merits the honor of an eponym. He sent dozens of children to their deaths as a conscious and willing participant in a program of systematic killing. So I have proposed that we discontinue this Asperger eponym in an op-ed for the New York Times, and this idea has gotten picked up. The book was just reviewed in Nature by a leading autism researcher, some of you may know him, Simon Baron Cohen, and he is also calling for us to no longer say the Asperger label based on this research. There are other conditions that have been named after Nazi-era doctors that have been renamed as a result of finding out their links to exterminationist programs. And medicine in general is moving away from eponymous diagnoses to more descriptive labels. The problem is, we just don't have an adequate vocabulary to talk about autism. Children diagnosed with the condition, you probably know many, can bear very little resemblance to one another. And so researchers suggest that autism is kind of a catch-all term right now that likely encompasses many different physiological conditions, and hopefully one day we will be able to split it up into different subtypes or different diagnoses. And right now, autism is an expansive umbrella label. And the analogy that comes to mind for me is similar to the diagnosis of female hysteria at the 19th and turn of the 20th century, which was basically a label for women who could not control their emotions, but they might be suffering from different condition: epilepsy, syphilis, schizophrenia, bipolar, depression, anxiety. Science just was not yet at a point to disaggregate these separate conditions. And I think that's where we are with autism right now, too. We just don't have the vocabulary. But I think it's an interesting question. What do we do in the absence of science? And to what extent are these diagnoses shaped by cultural influence? So hysteria happened at a time when women were asserting visible roles in public life, and the image of the hysterical woman captured the public mind. And now, I think the idea of an autism spectrum draws on anxieties about our children fitting into a fast-paced world, a fast-changing, fast-paced world. On the one end, a youth with autism might face a lifetime of disability and isolation, or on the other hand, might be perceived to have superior abilities and be a coding whiz in Silicon Valley, where I live. So Asperger hysteria was a diagnosis of overly emotional women, while now, if you think about it, autism is a diagnosis of supposedly under-emotional boys. The ratio of the diagnosis is 5-1, boys to girls, and the main image is white, urban, middle-class affliction. And so this is not to deny the very real challenges, of course, of children diagnosed with these conditions. That's not my purpose here today. My only purpose is to show how diagnoses can be fluid things, and that they emerge from the interactions of patients, doctors, social forces, media representations, and in a continual feedback loop, their meanings change over time. And I hope that with my book, by pointing out this changeability, I want to underscore the ethics of treating every child's mind with care because we know so little, and showing and warning how easily a society can issue labels, medications, and interventions. And may this research give us pause in considering how we describe and portray others, and hope that I can inform discussion from where we go from here with autism. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Edith. I've got the microphone here in the back center aisle, and I'd gladly bring it to the front row here for your first question.
Thank you for the presentation. It was very informative. I'm curious of your take. After all of your research, how do you feel that these doctors rationalized their behavior, whether it was for the greater good or they were just following orders? Why did they do what they did?
You would start off with the question. Just a brief anecdote. I took my daughter to see Anne Frank, The Diary of Anne Frank, and we had a backstage talk with the cast afterwards, and people were asking questions about lighting and costume, and my daughter raised her hand, and why did they do it? Why did the Nazis do it? I think they thought it was a scientific project. I think they believed it was the advancement of science. And eugenics was an extremely popular, respected science across the world at that time. And, in the United States, eugenicist leaders were on the forefront. Sterilization law, was current in 30 states at the time. And Nazi Germany was often admired as leading the forefront in sterilization, and the child euthanasia program was really an extension, a logical extension of sterilization. It was to kill children between 0 and 3 years of age at the beginning, and they just very carefully observed and recorded and tracked these children's daily needs. They and sent the reports to Berlin and got the reports back. To kill a child was not easy. It was not like other programs of Nazi extermination. It was incredibly scientific and deliberative. They believed in it.
Yeah. Next row back.
In Walter Isaacson's biography of Albert Einstein, he noted that Einstein did not talk until he was 4 years old. In fact, his aunt referred to him as my stupid nephew. If a three-year-old Albert Einstein, obviously he was an adult by the time this happened, but if a three-year-old Albert Einstein had been brought into Asperger's group, speculate on how he would have been diagnosed and what would have happened to him.
Yeah, I mean, I see exactly where you're going with this. And a three-year-old who was not talking and not developing and hitting the prescribed milestones would be in trouble at the time. And, you know, it was up to the doctor to report children with disabilities. And Asperger claimed after the war that he did not report children who he could have reported. And there's no way to prove that he might have withheld the names of some children. He may well have rescued children. I'm not here to deny that. And so if he went into Asperger's children, maybe, you know, an individual like him would have. But under law at the time, or under protocol, that Einstein would have had to have been reported.
The next row back.
You mentioned and give valid reasons for getting rid of the term Asperger's. Do you have a suggestion for what the diagnosis should be called?
I mean, in medical terms right now, it's autism spectrum disorder. And that's all we have. Often people say high functioning and low functioning. I hate that. I don't think that describes who a child necessarily is, or, you know, across what characteristics are you looking at when you say that. So my solution for the moment is to say on the spectrum. And then if people have questions about who that child is, you can describe the child or describe the person as who they are. So that's personally how I would see it. But I also don't mean to be too dogmatic saying that we need to get rid of the label, because people do self-identify, or people identify their children with it. And for years, often people have lived with this for most of their lives. And how can you tell someone how to identify, right? What I'm saying is, in the medical community going forward should be careful with this label. But retroactively, I don't, you know. And then Aspie is an interesting identity too, because to what extent is Aspie actually removed from a man? Is that a problematic label? But I do think, you know, I'm not gonna pretend to be an expert and where, you know, I think it was, the consensus was that Asperger's was already a problematic diagnosis, and that's why it was reclassified in 2013 anyway, and the World Health Organization is poised to do the same, to remove it from the ICD-11.
Dr. Sheffer, I have a question online here.
Okay. Wow.
Despite
high
your,
tech.
Despite the high praise online, in reviews, he's been held to high regard in the history, as you've explained. Have you received any blowback from supporters of his, or any family members he may have had, or is there any resentment for your findings?
Surprisingly, no. And I was really braced for this. I mean, I've had some negative comments on Twitter and Facebook, but I think by people who haven't read the book. I think once you see the facts, it's undeniable. I haven't heard directly from people who are personally affronted by this. So, yeah. I think people take it as serious history rather than as an attack of any sort.
A couple questions in the center here.
You mentioned the protests that occurred at the time. Was that driven by parents maybe who did not want their children killed, or just general humanistic, you know, care and concern?
Well, sure. So the protests, the slide that I showed with the pavilions, that whole complex is called Steinhof, and it held both children and adults. And thousands of adults were being killed there and deported off on trains to gas chambers. And so that is really what the public knew about. The killings of children were sort of whispered about and vaguely known, but what was causing the most outrage was this deportation of adults and the killing of adults at Steinhof. And so that's what was known, and those are the rumors that were circulating. And it's really incredible. I mean, the Nazi press was denying rumors. It was saying no such thing as gas chambers. And you do, right, so I'm, yeah. But I should say, To me, for those of you who know the history of the T4 euthanasia program, it's the only program of mass murder that the German population protested. It's the only, and they were able to do it quite openly with leaflets, with sermons, with protests. And Hitler technically shut down the program as a result of this popular protest. Now, I don't want to give you the wrong idea, continued in secret, but at least there was some effect. And if you do the thought experiment, well, what might have happened if people had been protesting other forms of extermination? And why was it only the killing of other Germans that was seen as, you know, objectionable enough to put yourself out there on the line?
In the back, towards the center?
I remember in the 50s and 60s, when it first, the concept of autism first came to the United States, the belief was it was because it was a cold mother that you know, and so the poor mother, not only did she have to deal with an autistic child that they usually didn't take in school, but then everyone was shunning her because they were, it didn't say like a cold father, it was right. A cold mother, you know.
The refrigerator mother.
That's right, you know, and that she had made this child distant.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, so ironically, this is one of the reasons Asperger is praised today, because he held that autism was genetic, and that it was not the parents' fault, that it was not the mother's fault, which sounds great, right? But if you look at his context, Nazi doctors are concerned with hereditary illness, right? Proving everything's hereditary, imbecility, every characteristic, gemüt is heritable, right? And so, right. And so it's just interesting that today how it's flipped on its head to point to suggest a heritable basis to autism is seen as more progressive than blaming it on the mother, right?
In the front to your right, Edith.
I was curious about the drawings in the slides. Were they done by the child that was featured? Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's a poignant drawing. I don't know how well you could see it because I'd shrunk it down, but when she was first brought to Asperger's clinic, that was Margarita, she was brought to take a bath. And she had a long talk with the nurse about her experiences. And the nurse, you know, in her notes said, Margarita just went on and on. I couldn't wait for her to shut up. And then she drew that picture. And you could see it was a really cheerful house. She had warm ideas of a loving home. But then she put herself as that solitary figure in the corner with the shower head on in the bath. So like seeing herself already in Asperger's clinic as the victim. Yeah.
Next question, I'll ask the gentleman to stand up, please. To your right, Edith.
Oh. Given how readily you uncovered these really disturbing facts about Asperger, why do you think it has taken so long for his reputation to go untainted?
That's another $64,000 question. I think it took a while for Nazi crimes to get uncovered in Austria anyway, and a handful of Austrian scholars do know about, have known about Asperger's involvement. It's just by comparison with other perpetrators, he was a very minor figure, right? He didn't work at Spiegelgrund, he was just transferring children there. So on the scale of perpetrators, Asperger was small fry. Right, and I think in the U.S. we have different standards for, you know, the horror factor, and then also in Austria, autism is well known of a diagnosis, and so he wasn't of interest due to that connection either. So the story behind how Asperger's disorder was accepted as an eponymous diagnosis in 1994, the team that was behind that wrote to, I think, five different archives saying, what do you know about Asperger? Can you please tell us? Because we don't want to go ahead and name this disorder after someone that might have been implicated, even despite his reputation. And a number of the archives wrote back saying, we don't know anything. We can't help you. And I think one scholar wrote back and said, we don't know enough to say no, but we know enough to say, hold on, and conduct more research. But at that time, the World Health Organization had already put Asperger's syndrome into the ICD-10, the International Classification of Diseases, so it was already in existence, and there was a lot of pressure to get Asperger disorder into the American manual. And, you know, maybe there's more to the story than I know about that, but yeah.
Edith, we have a number of hands up, and I'm gonna try to get to all of them.
I realize this is not in the scope of your study of your book, but in doing all your research, did you hear the first part of what
I said? Yes.
Okay.
Doing
all your research, did you stumble across anything that said what did they do with all the bodies of these children?
They would be buried, and you know, oh gosh, there's, yeah, I mean, they would be, there's just a horrific letter that I found from one man saying, you know, thank you for disposing of the body. I'm sorry, we couldn't make the burial of his child. So, yeah.
Dr. Sheffer, to your left.
You mentioned all the various etiologies of which genetics is a part. Mm-hmm. I'm a little uncomfortable with genetics alone being responsible for a logarithmic increase. What other things do you think might be playing a role in this increase?
Oh, well, I hazard just speak to this because I'm not, you know, in the science of autism, but the diagnostic, the expansion of the diagnostic criteria is one factor that everyone recognizes, right? That the what we think of as autism was widened, basically, on the idea based on Lorna Wing's work. Beyond that, I can't speculate. I mean, there are all kinds of theories, environmental or, yeah.
To your right.
Here.
Oh, hi.
You mentioned experiments being done on children. Did you found something in the archive if specifically Jewish children were targeted, or gypsies, or a particular part of the population?
Sure, so Jewish children and gypsies were not kept at Spiegelgrund in any kind of, you know, designated fashion. They were already deported elsewhere. So the children I'm dealing with were, you know, considered Aryan. Four of the children who perished at Spiegelgrund were Jewish or half-Jewish. So I can't speak to, say, Mengele's work on gypsy twins or anything like that, because at Spiegelgrund, yeah, that was not a factor. I should say, just on the question of what happened to the bodies, that 400, almost, you know, over half the children who perished at Spiegelgrund, their brains were kept in jars in the cellar. And as well as some other body parts, so not all remains were disposed of.
He who controls the microphone controls the last question.
Okay.
I already know the answer to this, but I'm fascinated by your work and having met you. Can you please let the crowd know what your next project is?
Oh, sure. It's a happier project. And it's of interest to your museum. I'm writing about Switzerland in World War II. I think Switzerland played a terribly important role that has yet to be recognized in not only at the economic front with trade and Holocaust gold, but in terms of the spy story with the OSS and Allen Dulles and Bern, as well as Nazi networks. My understanding is that the Stalingrad battle plans went through Switzerland and the battle plans for the Kursk, and I hope to uncover a lot of the secret stuff that was happening and what you could call Europe's post office. So I don't know if that's my title or not.
Well, we hope to have you back for that.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Have to thank Edith so much for this really wonderful talk. I think she did just a tremendous job of talking about something difficult but tremendously important to all of us to know about. And I think this is something to keep in mind for all of you as our wonderful audience here and online. We really present a diversity of topics. Although we're known mainly as a military museum, please come back and see us again, and you can expect the same breadth of wonderful presenters talking about a wide variety of topics. The next thing, I believe, is Paul Kicks with The Saboteur, is our next Meet the Author. You'll find that out via email, I'm sure. And also, we have a upcoming one-day symposium on the 20th anniversary of the film Saving Private Ryan. That's going to be super cool, and we'll include one of the cast members, right? It'll have the military advisor, Dale Dye, who you may remember as playing Colonel Sink in the film show Band of Brothers with such great effect. There's brochures for that around the place. But more importantly, get back there and get your book and have them signed by this wonderful, brilliant author. Thank you again, Edith.